Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. And it's my pleasure to be here. And the topic I'm going to present is entitled The Political Economy of Sustainability, and particularly the Africa's role in the realization of this Goal 7 of the Millennium Development Goals. And the contents of this presentation would be elucidation on the concept of sustainability itself, and then go on to the main global sustainable development activities, and I also highlight as to why do we need the political economy approach, and then would provide you some insights into the Africa's role in the achievement of sustainable development, and then give you a framework for our common future. A look at sustainability has long been, confusing and very much vague. Quite recently, it's a term that emerged to bridge, like, the gulf between the concept of development and environment. You have many people facing difficulty in terms of operationalizing as to what this sustainability substantially contains. The origin, when you look at the origin of the concept itself, it emanated in the studies of forestry and fishery and groundwater and other natural sciences, usually dealing with the questions like how many trees do we need when we cut and still have, a continuous growing of the forests. But gradually you have the application of this same concept to apply to almost every aspect of development. Crudely, it has been, defined in the 1980s. As a development meeting the needs of the present generation without compromising the ability of the future to meet its own needs. Some others have also tried to define as a compromise between the long-term wealth and well-being of the people. And you have this diagram, elucidating on how the concept is getting placed in different aspects of development. So you can see on the left side how it regenerates itself by way of pollution of poverty, and on the other hand you can also see how it is regenerating itself by way of pollution of affluence, and so you have several aspects and schemes of integration of the notion of environment into development and poverty reduction schemes. I have already mentioned that it is an eclectic concept, but the three foundational issues have been the environmental sustainability, economic sustainability, and the socio-political sustainability. You have this diagrammatic illustration of the sustainable development, the components of sustainable development. And so this is how important the political economy approach would be in sustainable. My goodness. It requires that the natural resources would be used in an appropriate and logical manner so that humanity or the survival of humanity will not be questioned in the future. And if we continue the usage and the utilization of our natural resources at a faster rate than they can be replenished, then we can say that we might simply face unsustainable situation. You can have a look at this picture, for instance. how the gods are moving upwards to the sky in search of something to eat. Gods are basically, they're not arboreals, but this time we are witnessing gods climbing over the tree. So, of course, when we talk about development, the human development, people have been talking about human development several times, and the importance of poverty reduction at various in various ways. But the point is that whether we can even sustain, whether we can even continue with our poverty. So that is why sustainability matters. We're not sure even we can sustain our life with our poverty. You have global activities which have been carried out at the global at the world level, and this include several conferences which are common to everybody: the UN Conference on Human Environment, the UN Conference on Environment and Development 2 decades later. And we also have the World Summit on Sustainable Development at Johannesburg in 2002. And the later one, we have the Copenhagen Summit. But the point is, to what extent these activities are institutionalized? I mean, to what extent institutions which are working for sustainability are doing well? Except for the legal framework, except for the different treaties that we have, we don't have a very genuine institution which is really working for sustainable development. You have several multilateral environmental agreements, different treaties which are often organized by secretariats. Some of the multilateral environmental agreements can be mentioned, like you have the Montreal Protocol on Substance that depleted the ozone layer. You have also the Kyoto Protocol, perhaps the fundamental multilateral environmental agreement, but nevertheless that has not been materialized. You also have the UN Framework Convention on the Climate Change, which has already been signed by more than 175 nations of the world. Recently, we are facing a challenge of course, adopting the Earth Charter, which seems to be inclusive and which seems to be important than ever. So why do we need a political economy approach in the sustainable development is that we need to make sure that the decision-making process is at the center of integrating environmental issues to our economic development. This approach has so far been quite relegated quite missing in the analysis of sustainability. And that's why I'm trying to come up with this issue as one aspect. It comes, for instance, here we have, where is the role of developing countries, sometimes known as the global south, which has so far been debatable in the international agenda, in the global agenda, and therefore, what is their role? The point comes from the assumption that the developed countries of the world are the most pollutant countries. They have been able to develop at the expense of polluting the international environment. And so who should take the responsibility for cleaning it up? And it means for most of the developing world who are in need of economic advancement, economic progress, sustainable development means that you don't have to grow. You don't have to undergo economic change like they have gone. And so for some it is also a kind of reversion to a pre-modern style. And so these states, after they have grown up themselves, are trying to, make us stay there. And so that is how debate continues. In one way or the other, it's putting a limit on the developing world, especially on Africa, the continent. The point is, who should be responsible for cleaning up the environment and to make our life sustainable? And so you have an agenda of discussion about environmental justice in the recent international conferences as to what should be or what is the role of this developing world in the international institutional decision making. The idea is that money is influencing decision making. Most of the money for the international institutions come from developed world or different institutions of developed world, and it goes to the international or different global organizations, and then it is influencing decision making in their own favor. And so in principle, we have this framework of the United Nations systems, where you have different stakeholders, different bodies, different committees and different regional organizations, which are in principle assumed to take part in the process of decision making to come up with some concrete framework for sustainable development. But in reality, this is not the case. Let me just provide a brief framework, a brief contribution of Africa in this regard. You have a role at the regional level. At the regional level, you have very good jobs by the Economic Commission of Africa through Sustainable Development Division, the SDD, which has been so far involved in the promotion of policy instruments and different analytical tools like the PEDA, or the Population Environment Development and Agriculture, and the Natural Resource Accounting. At the national level, states can do their own affairs, their own things at the national level. This table of the Economic Commission of Africa report, the category. It's of 2008 data, but at least it can tell us some issues about how countries are doing well or doing bad at the national level. You have different categories of nations which are doing genuinely with the environment and doing relatively fine about the environment, doing fine but incomplete institutional framework at the national level, and so on. You also have this same data from the Economic Commission of Africa, a data in 2008. You have different environments, the political and legal environment, which is permitting the integration of sustainable principles or principles of sustainability in the process of development. As I have also mentioned earlier, multilateral environmental agreements are one aspect in which the African nations can contribute. You have different multilateral and bilateral initiatives which have been carried out so far to ensure the coherence and the coordination of the environmental impact assessment at the regional as well as sub-regional levels, particularly after the conference which has been held in 1995, the Durban Conference. You have the establishment of different sub-regional institutes dealing with sustainable development, the Southern African Institute for Environmental Assessment. This is one aspect in which these nations are making point. The other you have at the Eastern Africa you have, and you also have an institution dealing with environmental assessment in West Africa, and the METAP in the Northern Africa. So the Mediterranean Environment Protection Technical Assistance Program. So, I mean, how do we see our common future? So that is one point I would like to make. So some people are trying to talk about a global governor of environment, the global governor of environment. We already have the UNEP, the United Nations Environmental Program, which is weak enough to enforce even multilateral or different treaties. But could it be the World Environment or World Environmental Organization? That is a kind of proposal that some people are talking about. But there is a fear that it can also emerge as the World Trade Organization, which is trying to make a framework for the global regulation of the international trade, but at the same time, against the interest of most of the developing world. And so there is this fear that, of course, it has to be powerful, but it has to be democratic as well. It has to include different nations or different regions of the least developed countries in the world, including Africa. And above all, different communities at various levels, different countries and different regions, different continents of the world need to they need to have reformed policies and different laws and increase their capacities, but above all, political willingness of our leaders and political commitment as well is important to make sure that whether not only we develop in the future, but also because whether our survival is in question. I mean, sustainability depends on much on the political willingness and political commitment of our leaders. Thank you very much.
It's quite a seriously academic one, because you seem to. You see, I'm beginning to look at these MDGs afresh. Because at some point I begin to think maybe some political economy approach or agenda would have been worked out for the African leaders first before just jumping into, okay, yeah, we need education, we need road, we need good health and that. Because it seems most of the collapse or the pitfalls we are getting seems to be this leadership thing. Whether we, like you see that it's ODA or whatever you put it, leadership seems to be critical, because whether MDG or no MDG, as government, we owe the responsibility to provide for people, reduce infant mortality and that. And I'm beginning to think, because this issue of this climate change thing, for instance, I recall working with an NGO in my local community, telling the people that, look, don't use firewood. Firewood is bad. And then you have the challenge of not providing them with some alternative. You can't even provide a cooking stove for them or kerosene and that. And then you are telling them don't deforest, no deforestation and that. I'm beginning to seriously fear we have an important program to fix the problems of the world under this climate change that we approach wrongly. Because, yes, my grandmother would still not believe using firewood or felling the forest or even bush burning is wrong. And we call global community, global world, one world and that. And this affects even the people in the city. I'm beginning to think as an academic, just trying to tell us political will, political that, because the same people like the other prof mentioned, and maybe the other prof here, you are the people that do these reports, you are the people that put these things on the website and tell us all this. How do we resolve this political will thing? Because it's a complicated issue. Very easy to push it to political will, which we all know. The will is not there, corruption and all. It's so easy, but it's becoming a challenge. Because, like you recall, we have heard of people, military, they come, they take over, they tell us, look, corruption, corruption, corruption. Then they come, there are people that even start the corruption. The same with the civilian rulers and things like that. So from your experience, how do we respond to this political will thing that seems to be underpinning these issues, beyond just identifying it as a problem?
Thank you, Prof. Thank you, everybody here. I want to look at a general overview of his presentation and take us back about this global environmental degradation, global warming, and pollution and all that. If you look at the world now, much of the world pollution is coming from the developed West, from the industries, from the automobiles, and this has been transferred into the African continent. The automobile we drive, the fumes are part of the larger pollution of the society. The industries that we use to manufacture are also part of the pollution of the society. And this goes to a global, it becomes a global situation. Now, when you talk about the political will, how can an African leader have a stronger political will against a Western leader who finances his economy? And that's why they keep blaming the less developed countries for pollution, when they really know that they are the cause of this pollution. I think we are breaking the issue when we are looking at the African continent for solution. The solution should come from where it's initiated. The developed world have brought this problem onto Africa. The little pollution that he's talking about, the firewood, has been there. It never was any serious threat.
Tell us to stop.
And even when we stop, we're still using gas, which also has pollutants. We're still using kerosene, we still have pollutants. So whichever way we look at it, we might just be begging the situation, but instead of looking at the crux of the matter, it's the developed West that is bringing this problem. And they initiated it, they should help us solve this. But because they finance the world economy, the world shift the blames away and take the credit for any little effort that has been put in the positive direction. I think we should look at it from the other way around, rather than looking at Africa for a solution. We have not even contributed one third of the world population, pollution, and as to what the West is contributing through the industrial pollution. Like the other prof just mentioned, what is happening in Beijing, you know, because of the level of manufacturing that is happening in Beijing and the automobiles that they use, to a level that they ban some vehicles in Beijing that you can't drive in certain periods. You need to be from Beijing to register a vehicle. That's another way of reducing the pollution and the crowding. All these are add up to the global warming and the global pollution we are talking about. And so if we are looking at leadership, the willpower, the African leader has not got it. Even if he hasn't got it, he has the willpower. He'll be isolated if he attempts to implement his willpower. The global, the world will isolate him as being radical left. They think he's out of the way. But I think that is the break that we need. If we must have a break that we have to divorce ourselves from what the West is doing, then so be it. If not, then the West should tell us a way out of this quagmire, because they're possible. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This is Freywood from Addis, from African Youth Trust. I wanted to forward this question to the previous presenter, but it's the same. Most of the agendas are the same. So I wanted to forward it to you, Prof. Thank you for the presentation. I always wonder of these development agendas, where are they designed, who designed them, and when we come to the implementation and when we come to the being successful, the successfulness of these development agendas, I don't know, in your profession or who are the evaluators, what are the indicators of the implementation of these development agendas? We've seen Nepad, we've seen the MDGs, immediately after the MDGs, then came NEPAD, and there are also other development agendas of that we know and that we don't know in other African countries and for Africa by, I don't know who designed them, but it comes to Africa and it's not practical and it's not implemented and it's not successful. So are there initiatives from the local, like in our case, are there initiatives from our professors, from our intellectuals, that can be a development agenda to the countries? Are there other African countries who have their own development agendas, and why are not they successful? Like in our case, if I can mention, there are local ways that we solve conflicts. There are ways that practically done in a, like if you take a good governance, like in a tribe called Oromo, you have a system called Gada, where there is a practical good governance implemented for a very long time. If you go to Rwanda, there are local initiatives that are that can solve conflicts through their own elders and all, and they have implemented it. It's not the Western or it's not the outsider who solved the Rwandan case, if you study there. And it was presented by one South African in April in the ICD conference. So what can you say about all these development agendas and the questions I mentioned? Thank you very much.
The presentation is quite academic. I think the answer is very simple, because I'm from the academic institution. About the issue we have been talking about, our contribution, particularly in the world economy and so forth, we have to also, I think we need to look at from the political perspective as well. Mind you, this continent has more than 50 states, about 54, 55 states. And so you can also imagine what this means in terms of, in terms of political voice. I think we can use this voice to influence the global institutions. I mean, making pressure through the even the United Nations and other international bodies. And so the quest is to make those international institutions make them more democratic, to include us in their process of decision making. And so that is maybe the point I'm trying to look at the issue. I think sustainability is very narrowly understood. Very narrowly understood. Even when you hear people talking about sustainable development, they talk about climate change. And when they talk about climate change, they simply talk about global warming. You can also think about the issue of global cooling. For instance, you can remember what happened to River Danube last year. A river frozen, actually, for some time. And so that, again, is a problem. And we are not only concerned about the physical and the natural environment when we talk about sustainability. Even sustaining our institutions is an aspect of sustainable development. Sustaining our democratic institutions, sustaining our culture, sustaining our feelings and our satisfaction. That is what sustainability has to deal with, what sustainability of institutions at all level, at the national, at the local, and even at the international level have to deal with and make meaning to their life. This is one point. But about your question, I think that is how nations can play at their own, within their own domain, and therefore, I guess even to maintain those cultures, to maintain those systems is part of sustainability. That's what I believe in. So governments have to appreciate like the re-emergence, if you like, the rebirth of those traditional systems which are effective enough in dealing with conflicts, in dealing with different natural and physical environments. And so I think that is what they have to make use of. That is how they have to deal with their even local and indigenous culture, indigenous institutions. So if they're wise, they have to make use of that. And that's what I think.
And it's not really a question. The issue of leadership and commitment has been coming up. I also recall that Dr. Oga raised the issue of conflicts and queried why it is not included in the MDG agenda. And I feel I should offer a little explanation, and it may help. If we look at the whole concept of the MDGs, you'll find out that 189 heads of states came together after a series of conferences and meetings and summits and discovered that they had a challenge. Challenge of poverty, challenge of health issues, challenge of environmental issues. So already the leadership have identified that they had a problem. So raising issue of commitment, issue of way, and looking at it as if it has not really been included in the MDG program is really not proper. They had already identified this as a challenge, and it was the heads of states that together put their thoughts and came up with the Millennium Declaration. So I think they had already identified that, and I wish I should raise that. And if you also look at the issue of peer review mechanism adopted by NEPAD, which is the African version of the MDGs, you find out that the peer review itself is issue of trying to a sort of review leadership policies and strategies as it's adopted in African nations. And the whole essence of the peer review mechanism is to see that democracy and good governance is encouraged in African nations, and issue of financial management or resources is also encouraged. So I think the MDGs as a concept has really accommodated the issue of leadership, and they have identified leadership as a very major factor in the attainment of MDGs. Thank you so much.